Remember the context in which everything is being said here, which is that the explanation for this world is something entirely different than what we assume. This is the basic context, entirely different. And most of us in this world really don't have a clue about what this world actually is, what it's about. Not even the foggiest notion. So what we're trying to do here is we're trying to find out, well, what is this situation we're in, we seem to be in, we're experiencing, seem to be experiencing. What is it actually? If you listen to some of the Buddha sutras, some of the famous ones, they say very plainly, it's entirely a mental construct. Entirely, even false mental construct, delusory mental construct is all that it is. You know? And so we have these explanations for what this world is. And most of us, you know, don't pay much attention to it. And we really don't know what's going on here. We all assume we know. I mean, you would think if you ask anybody, they'd have an answer. Oh yeah, they come up with some answer. But I've never heard, other than the great teachers, I've never heard a good explanation for this world at all. And even the great teachers, it's not easy to understand what they say. So it's context, context, context here, always. What we do is we move our comfort zone closer to the answer. There is an answer there. There's no question, I have no doubt about it, that there are those who have discovered what this situation actually is. And it's, now what Jesus says is, in transcribing to Dr. Brent Haskell, what about the world, what is this world? It was an article, an essay, What is the World by Jesus, and his explanation was just, you know, quite extraordinary. And what he says is that we have spent incredible attention to detail and cleverness in designing this world to deceive ourselves. And he says we have left no I undotted or T uncrossed. We have looked at every possible facet and meticulously accounted for everything we can account for to try and produce this illusion of a reversal of cause and effect. So you might say it's an extraordinary illusion, delusion, deception, this world. An extraordinary deception. This is Jesus' viewpoint. Now, I happen to believe what he says from various peak experiences. But in ordinary consciousness and perception of this world, it don't have a clue. Go around this world, you can just say, well, I don't know what this place is, or why it's here, or what we're doing here, or what this means, or, you know, don't know. And why we have acted so strangely throughout history on this planet, most people don't know. We have faith that there is an answer, and we can move our comfort zone closer and closer to that answer, which is what we're doing here. And we get glimpses of it, and then we just say, wow, that's nothing like the world believes at all. And then we think, wow, I need to come up with maybe a compromise, because how in the world can I teach, the world what's really going on when their beliefs are so completely different? You know, it just seems impossible, actually. And maybe it is impossible to teach directly. So what I say is, there is no way to teach it directly. You have to move your comfort zone gradually in the direction of your spiritual intuition points out to you, with the help of the Holy Spirit, with the help of God, with the help of Jesus, with the help of the great teachers. And gradually, you're willing to accept, you know, accept the truth of the situation here. But certainly you just can't sit down and explain it to someone, because it's totally different than what they expect, and so much so they can't even understand or grasp it, or let alone accept it. And the continuity fear, which I say is the only problem there is so extreme, nobody is going to be able to just accept it through an explanation. That's ridiculous to even, you know, believe that at all. This is the problem. People say, oh, well, if you have the answer, explain it to me. And I'm saying the answer is so completely different than what you can even imagine it to be, that there isn't any way. And your fear, your absolute dread of realizing what's going on here, and the realization that nothing's ever happened, and that all is perfect, is so extreme that there's no way you can just directly accept it. You're going to defend against it. So you cannot simply go along the path, the way that the world is viewing learning, okay? The what we're taught in our culture are not the skills and tools needed on the spiritual path at all. This is why I say we've gone into a severe dark period, dark ages right now. Very, very bad dark ages. I was shown that in this video of the future. I was watching a dream, and I was shown what's going to happen in the future. And it certainly, everything has happened. And I saw us then coming into, after the economic downturn, severe recession, then the world is going to go into this very, very dark time, ages, pitch dark almost, where they will simply not have the necessary tools to go upon the spiritual path, and they won't even really be aware of the spiritual path, and it will just sort of massive disinterest and disengagement from it. A super, super dark time in the world. And so it's, you know, up against this, it's just, you have to sidestep it, really. And just wait until they have changed their mind, you know, and the dark ages, they want to finally say, enough of this. This hasn't worked for us. Again, I say it's a matter of moving your comfort zone. It's not an intellectual accomplishment at all. It's an epic accomplishment of discipline, determination, dedication, persistent practicing, focusing your attention, gradually moving your comfort zone. It's a lifetime accomplishment sort of thing. It's like a career. But it's like a career of a highly skilled craftsperson, like that, where the person really, really knows, really applies themselves to their craft, and they become expert at it. It's like that. In a previous life, in Europe, I was a craftsman, one of those I can remember. I was a very highly skilled craftsman, dedicated my life to being a craftsman. Well, now I just turned that dedication to the spiritual path, and applied a lot of the same, you know, skills, even though it's a little bit different, but some of the skills are the same, where it's an art, it's a craft. You cannot pin it down, you can't pin the path down, you can't teach the path, you can only inspire and reassure on the path. It cannot be taught. There's no way it can be taught. And so this culture is demanding that anything that can't be taught doesn't have any value, which is ludicrous, you know. But this is the mindset of the world. What can you do except just step back from it and don't engage it, really? So what can be done in these dark ages? I don't know. What I've seen is sidestepping it and saving your effort for, well, as far as trying to teach it, saving that effort for a time when there are those who are interested, actually, and have the skills to do it and are willing to use those skills. It's almost like an unlearning exercise, an unlearning, dropping the whole issue of learning. Keep in mind, God did not create spirit as needing to learn anything. Spirit is an extension of God. Spirit is God. Okay, it's an extension of God. God extending itself is what's called spirit. Spirit is perfect. It's functioning, and its basic nature and functioning is absolutely perfect. And it can never stray from that. There's nothing the spirit has to learn. They're not like lessons the spirit has to learn, has to complete itself, or not at all. Jesus says actually the spirit has access to every idea there could ever possibly be. There's nothing the spirit doesn't know. So the idea that it needs to learn is ludicrous. So we're here teaching learning, which I always found to be totally odd. I said, if I want to know the answer to a question, I'll know the answer. If I don't want to know it, then it doesn't come to mind. There's no issue of learning involved, actually. I remember just listening to stuff and people say, asking blah 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 blah, what's the answer? And if I wanted to know the answer, I just say, okay, I want to know the answer, and then there was the answer. And I give them the answer, and they say, how did you do that? How did you do that? How did you do that? And I say, what do you mean? Well, I did it. I just said, I decided I wanted to know the answer, and there it was. There's no how to it. And so I find that this world is, you know, completely bizarre place. And not just from a spiritual standpoint, because the spiritual standpoint is the only standpoint there is. There's not some other standpoint. There's not some other reality from which you can judge this world. It's only from the standpoint of spirit, from a standpoint of reality, this world is bizarre, extremely bizarre. It's an attempt to change reality. And the good news is nothing has changed reality at all. So, as though there's a way of looking at this all as not bizarre, which is look at the world with no value whatsoever. Just equal appearance, equal vision, equal appearance. You know, no, there's no value, relative value at all to this world. In fact, there isn't. There's no relative value to this world whatsoever. And it's possible in the vision of oneness to see this. In other words, nothing in this world has changed or altered reality in the slightest bit. So it's all zero. It's all no value in terms of that. But in terms of appearances and stuff, it's just everything's equally an appearance. No separation between arising and subsiding, non-manifesting, all the same. And so this is a non-dual vision of oneness that we're moving our comfort zone towards. And every day move a little further. I moved it further today. But there, as far as like teaching it, it's not possible. It's not possible at all. You cannot teach the path. It cannot be taught. You can only live the path. Because it's an internal struggle where you're trying to keep your equilibrium and move your comfort zone and be patient and, you know, it's this great struggle to make this leap of faith, this quantum leap into realizing that there is no leap. Yeah, and that's quite a leap. The leap to realize there's no leap, that's a leap, because we keep believing that there's something needs to happen. Some leap has to happen. And then to realize there is no leap at all is the leap. So yeah, it's still a leap. Let's say you're on this stone and there's a chasm there, and there's another stone across the chasm, and you feel you need to leap across it. And so for a billion years, you've been training yourself and teaching yourself how to make that leap across the chasm to this other side, to the rock on the other side of the chasm. And you know, just spent this incredible effort of studying this and thinking and all that, you know. Okay, now what if you realize you don't need to make the leap at all? Now wouldn't that be a huge leap in a different way? The leap of realizing there is no leap to make. Certainly it would be. It's a different way of defining leap, but it certainly is just as valid definition. So you is a massive shift, like going in reverse. It's where you're all your expectations suddenly completely gone. You leapt out of your expectations, as it were. So we don't need to leap. There, in fact, not only do we not need to leap, there isn't any possibility of ever making any leap. Same thing with a path. There isn't a path is impossible. So for all this time, believe we had to finish the path, and then we realize there's never been any path. And since there's never been any path, there isn't any such thing as finishing. Don't need to finish any path. The idea of finishing a path is what gives rise to the idea of a path. But we don't need to finish any path. So the truth is, there's never been any. This is a huge leap, as it were, a leap into accepting where we already are. This is the great leap. But if this is approached intellectually, we'll never get it. We'll never get it. It has to be approached on a level of experiential level. Something deep down inside. Just like we have to drag that garbage bin out to the street, right? for in order for it to be picked up, we have to drag our comfort zone. The intellectual approach is by those who are in a hurry for fame and fortune. Meanwhile, we're dragging these bins out, these garbage bins out, you know, working hard at it, just, you know, putting the effort into it, dragging things along. It's difficult, slow, can't go too fast. It's kind of a drag. It's kind of a drag. Sure it is. Spiritual path is kind of a drag. It's difficult. Many days, many days, many efforts. No matter how far you get, every day is still, you know, still have to work at it. So again, the answer is so far afield from the expectations of the mind. And there's such drastic continuity fear, there isn't any way this a direct explanation can be accepted, understood, appreciated. It's not possible. And for a society that insists that if it can't be given that way, then it must not be true at all, is, you know, they're just being ridiculous. So what is the explanation for, again, for this world? Right? In order to explain it to anyone here, you have to go beyond it. Even beyond any success in explanation. Go beyond explanation. Because what's beyond explanation? Once you get it, then what? So you have to actually be aware of what is beyond existence, actually. Otherwise, people will say, well, okay, so I get the answer, then what? You know, they can say that kind of thing, and then you'll be tripped up if you don't know, then what? So you cannot really be just one of the crowd in this world and teach successfully at all. It's not possible. You have to be beyond the confusion, even beyond the answer, in order to share the answer. And it is certainly interesting. I have to find out. I don't think I can teach it. I'm not able. I think a teacher, someone who has to, who have gone beyond the explanation, the answer, to once you resolve the situation, then what? That, you know, I have to know then what. What do you do? Well, if you realize that bliss is uncaused and it's all equally present everywhere, no more, no less, it's completely inherent. There's nothing we need to do. Then you say, well, what do we do then? You see, we're used to judging doing as more and less, like I do this, I get more, I can do this, I get less. So we're constantly judging and doing, thinking we need to do something here. So when you realize that doing is nothing I need to do, then what do you do? See, that's our question, right? What are you doing? Then you realize there's nothing I need to do, nothing that anyone needs to do. And that seems like a great mystery to us all here. And so that mystery is so severe to all of us, you need to have the answer to that. You have to know the answer to be able to insist that people keep working towards, you know, realizing the inherent bliss and freedom of reality that is uncaused, that is simply present, equally omnipresent, without any doing involved whatsoever. And it's not affected by any arising appearances or not arising. It has zero effect upon it all, upon the basic nature of reality. It has no effect at all. And so most of us would say, well, I don't need to do anything. But then what do? So this idea, I don't need to do anything, then what? Okay. And I think this holds a lot of us back. So I'm like, wow, I wouldn't know how to function. If you think about it, function in this world is based on those who believe they know what needs to be done. And you see, nothing needs to be done. At all. Ever. Then what do you do? Yes, we're afraid that we'll just like sit and do nothing. Even though that's never been... Well, Ramana Maharshi did sit and do seemingly nothing. But He actually accomplished more than we can possibly understand by helping bring us out of the sense of doing, of needing to do something. See, if there's no need whatsoever, then we don't call it doing. But anyway, we have to. This is a great blockage for us. We're very concerned and frightened about, I won't know what to do. If I realize there's nothing I need to do, I won't know what to do. If I realize that nothing, no effect can be brought about whatsoever, really. Nothing can be changed. What do I do then? That seems to be a great puzzle for us all. And Jesus says you can't really explain it. It's not really possible to explain it here, but don't worry about it. So we have to have some trust in this. And just continue. Towards the vision of oneness, moving the comfort zone towards the vision of oneness. Just continue with it. Now you might say, well, what I would do is make sure I don't ever get pulled down into this delusion again, and maybe take steps to reinforce the truth, and take steps to feel completely at ease and comfortable and adjusted to truth and accepting of it. And then beyond that, Jesus says there's not much that can be said, because the glory cannot explain it in the terms of this world and bodies and thinking, all that can't be explained or understood, cannot. So we'll just accept it. The idea of what to do to gain an advantageous position is not necessary. There's only adventitious position. That's all there is. And everybody's already in it. So you don't need to change anything. Everybody's already in total adventitious position. That's a fact, you see. You just reassure them that they can, that this is true, and they can recognize this and experience it. But we're all trying to get into a non-adventitious position, which is impossible. We're working very hard at it. You look, you know, take a walk through the streets of Calcutta, or wherever, Benares, or any, you know, crazy city, and all these, see everybody, and you say, oh my gosh, everybody seems to be working so hard for what? Everything seems to be disadvantageous, you know. And it almost seems like, you know, you think, huh, it seems like people are trying to get themselves into a disadvantageous position in relation to reality. And if you see it's impossible to do that, then you just have a laugh, I guess, at the whole thing. And then you're through with it. So this may be an expression of what's really going on in this world, is everyone's trying to get into a disadvantageous position. They're trying to get out of pure spaciousness and trying to, you know, somehow position themselves in this world and the body and everything. And it's all completely useless, futile. So you could say everyone is in a perfectly advantageous position. All is, absolutely. So this would be one way of looking at it. This is what I'm looking, the way I'm looking at it right now. And we'll see how that goes. you know, that's the question, why do we suffer? There's a good answer right there, isn't it? We're trying to find a way out of reality, you know, we just somehow get into some situation. We think maybe this, maybe I've escaped reality. Maybe I've escaped perfection. I'm here breaking bricks on a road in Bangladesh, you know, pouring out tar and stuff, and blazing hot sun, and I just got sick, I got diarrhea, and you know, it was just, it's like, maybe now, you know, maybe I've got, finally have reached it. No. That's why a sage can walk by and just at a glance can liberate. Because they just look and they know that you're in a perfect position. You can never be in a disadvantageous position whatsoever. And they know that, you know, and someone's ready sees that. And there's a connection. They say, ah, they say, you don't know, it could be someone breaking bricks on a road in Bangladesh who is ready to be liberated. Because this is their final effort to be disadvantageous, you know. And they see, then they see, ah, even this doesn't do it. Even this doesn't do it. Yeah. And we're all competing to be the first one who gets into a disadvantageous position. I'm closer than you are, you know. In fact, no one is in the slightest fit. Everyone's in a perfect situation. So, there isn't any closer at all. Now, of course, this explanation will meet with just incredulity and outrage by most of the people, and most of us in the world. So you're crazy. What are you talking about? In other words, so you try to explain what's going on, the world will not accept it. It's so completely different than what they're thinking. Of course, they're thinking they're tricking reality, you see. And they're going to get reality to shift and move somehow as they get in this position. And they're playing a chess match with reality, when in fact there's no chess match going on at all. So certainly this could be a great relief. I'm feeling that, yeah, great relief. No chess match is going on whatsoever. We're moving all these chess pieces, thinking reality's moving. Reality's not making any move. Doesn't need to. There's no moves whatsoever. Interesting, yeah. So, feels like this is along the lines, you know, of explanation. But it's, again, it's so, we're so into trying to succeed, we keep thinking reality is trying to trick us or make a move. It's not making any move. Never has made a single move. It's all our own moves and our imagination and our belief and our hopes, whims, desires. But nothing's happening. Nothing's ever happened. We're never out of place. You can't be out of place in reality. You cannot be in a disadvantageous position whatsoever. Everyone is in a perfectly advantageous position, perfect position. Can't be otherwise than that. Cannot be otherwise than that. So, this is at least, you know, how I would talk about tonight. I would talk about the sage, what the sage knows, is aware of. It's worth considering. And you can see how people are upset and angry at the sage. They don't want to talk to the sage because they think they've almost tricked reality. They've almost juked reality out, like as if they're faking, you know, faking like this and trying to fake out reality so they can slip past it or something, score a touchdown, get separate from reality. Reality is not reacting at all to any of it. We're just psyching ourselves out, actually. We keep thinking, oh, maybe reality, I think reality might have moved there. Okay, let me counter that. Okay, we're just making up these moves that don't exist by reality. These reactions that don't exist. These adjustments that don't exist. Reality is not reacting or adjusting in the slightest bit to our shadow play of trying to get into a non-advantageous position. So you would say the vision oneness is completely smooth, no ripples, absolutely still and smooth. Everything is in a perfect position, perfectly included. No one is flawed in the slightest bit. There's no flaws at all. And nothing is happening to this fact whatsoever. This would certainly bring about a different attitude, wouldn't it? It would certainly explain the attitude of the great sages, wouldn't it? Yeah. How they look around, smiling at everybody. Right? They see. People say, what are you smiling at? You know? They think, I'm in a terribly disadvantageous position. I'm horrible. Are you kidding me? And all this. And they just smile. They know the truth. Those are the great sages, you know, that's it. Can't fool them. You come to them and say, I got so many problems, I got this and this, I'm in such a horrible situation, I'm in such a disadvantageous position. Yeah, it's horrible, you know, I'm out of sorts, and you know, and you can't fool them, and they just smiling. You say, what's wrong with them? They're crazy or something. I told them all my troubles. I confided in them, and they're acting like nothing's wrong. You know, it's like, what in the world is going on here? They're seeing the reality of your situation, actually, which is perfect. Because you don't have any situation or conditions. You're perfectly free. You're perfect. Your situation is perfect because you're perfectly free. How could it not be perfect? So, you see how unexpectedly different it is than what we expect. But if we've moved our comfort zone along enough, we can entertain this, you know, and just entertain it, that's all. Just entertain this, yeah. So you cannot give up your own delusion without giving up everybody else's too. You can't just see yourself free and others bound at all. It's impossible. Because freedom is one, is omnipresent. The perfection of reality is omnipresent. So when you realize that you are in a perfect situation, you have to realize that everyone is in a perfect situation. You can't be saved alone. It's impossible. This is also Jesus' teaching. We're all in the same perfect situation, which of no situation. So you have to be a sage, you know? A great sage. There's no way around it. There's no way around it. Because you have to see everybody is in a perfect situation. There's no non-advantageous situation possible, actually. Nobody has succeeded at all in putting themselves into a bad situation. No one. So you have to be the great sage, which sees everyone exactly the same, that they're all in a perfect situation. You can't be one, see some that as that way and others as not. It's not possible. It tends to bring a little chuckle along with it. So these are the great stories that we've heard of situations. I grew up on all these stories of the gurus and the sages and people coming to them and telling, "Oh, I did, look how this has happened to me, and this and this and this and this and this." And the sage is not fooled by any of it, you know. Look how all this stuff has happened to me. And nothing's happened. We've done everything to ourselves to try to prove that we can get out of sorts with everywhereness, get out of sorts with the nature of reality. We can't. We cannot. So no one's coming to you with any problems. No one can have any problems, actually. Yes. They're just hoping to fool reality. They come and say, I wonder if I can fool them, you know, fool them. I need to fool reality, you know. Reality, as if reality could be fooled. Reality's foolproof. Prayed to God today, and this is what God has delivered. Jesus advised praying to God, actually. He says that's the highest prayer. Why don't you give it a try? So, okay, I gave it a try, and I have this explanation now, which is superior to other explanations so far. Is it the final explanation? I don't know, but it certainly is. Seems to bring more hope, and like, wow. This is great. Yes, it brings more laughter up, for sure. Very good. So today, tonight, I can say thank you, God, you know. Appeal directly to God today. Which Jesus says we absolutely should do. That's the best. But not many do that. I think we're afraid we might get the answer, you know, if we do that. We realize that we're not out of sorts. We've never been, and nobody is. Very great. All right, so we'll see how this settles like a meal. See how it goes down like that. Yeah. But give a try, just saying the name of God, 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 God. Just appeal to God. Say the name of God over and over and over and over and over. This is like the highest practice. Don't ask anything specific, just appeal straight to God. God, 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 God. God knows that you're asking for the answer. So, I've had several great answers today. This is the first time I've ever done that, really. Just say the name of God over and over and over and over and over as an appeal. So I highly recommend giving that a try, just like I did. I just gave it a trial run, and it's borne really very good fruit today. Tremendous. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.